Good morning, everybody. Good morning. Welcome to 11-11 Celebration. Glad you came out this morning. I woke up this morning, and I got to be honest with you, I didn't want to come to church today. Yeah, no, it's just the rain, and it's like we don't get rain very often, and it shows up, and I was so excited, and I looked. Linda was already in the, you know, in the bathroom, and I said, "Honey, it's Saturday, right?" She says, "No, you got to get back up." So, like half an hour later, I asked her again if it was really Sunday or not. But so good to have you here this morning. And we got a couple of quick things to make announcements about. But as we do that, make sure that you sign this little card that's in your chair and put your email. Oh, you know, put your email on there because what happens is just because your name is on there, it doesn't go down. Lots of times people think, well, I put my email on there, you know, months ago. They already know what my email is. But when Charmin and I send out these cards and stuff every couple of months, they're sent out by the emails. So if you didn't register an email during the 2 or 3 months you were attending, then you won't get the wonderful card that we send out and other information that we send out. I'm always amazed at why people are not getting some emails. And it's because we need to have that every week just to kind of keep, that's how the computer system here works. So I was about to put a name tag on that doesn't have my name on it. All right, we'll just do that. All right, there we go. So other announcements here really quickly. Charm got finished with a group yesterday, Habitat for Humanity. We finished those up. Our series has been participating in what was going on with this building blitz that we participated with other churches in the county. And I don't know how many churches were finally built. I mean, houses finally built. But we had 6 or 7 houses on that block that we're working on. So it was a really exciting thing to have you all participate in that, a number of you folks. Over the 3 weeks that the church was involved, who in here, if you want to raise your hand, who in here was involved in that? Okay, yeah, nice. Yeah, I think all total we had something like 25 or so people involved between the 3 weekends. So great, that was really exciting. Let's see, we're moving to a new worship space. I'm going to probably give a couple of minutes during the sermon time, just maybe to answer any questions rather than now. But you no doubt have gotten notifications in the mail. I hope to God you didn't click the video link that has the interview with me and my. Did you click? Anybody click? Don't click it. I hate those interviews. And anyway, though, but it's informative and it's there. But you can read the letter, the email, and get all the information you need to know about that as well. We're going to do something fun on the 3rd that will be kind of exciting, but more about that later on. But that's our June 10th. What day are we going to be having our first service at the ballroom at the historic 512? June 10th. That's right. Okay. So don't get it confused. We'll be over there. You can come here, but you'll get here, and there'll already be a group in here, and you'll be late if you come here, because they started 12, 15 minutes ago. All right, so I think that's enough for announcements right now. Let's begin with our welcome candle. Whoever you are, wanderer, worshiper, lover of leaving, it doesn't matter.
Much too fast to take that test. Changing
faces strange.
always seem the same. And these children that you spit on as they try to change the world are immune to your consultations. They're quite aware of what they're going through.
As we prepare our hearts for worship this morning, I have to tell something really, really fast. I promise I'll be very brief, very brief. So I was crossing the street over here in my office. My office is in the foundation building for my nonprofit, not for the church, but my office over here. And crossing that street is one of the most anxiety-producing moments of my life every day. And so last Tuesday, I have both of the girls. I picked them up from preschool, and I was crossing the street. I'm trying to wrangle both of them across the street and trying not to get hit by a car, and I hear this voice, "Hello, ladies," and I was like, okay, we got to hurry and go even faster now, and I look over, and there's a man across the street, like, looking at us, and I was like, okay, we've got to hurry. I'm like, Maisie, come on. She's stopping to look at the post office or the mailbox and everything, and then he asked me where the courthouse is, and I was like, I'm sorry, I don't know, and I'm trying to drag him along. Well, it turns out, please don't ever, I know I could recognize all of you if you were as you are, please don't ever put on a hat, because it was Joe. My buddy Joe. And so I feel that I have to confess this, because here we are, and I always pray for an open spirit and an open community in which we are friendly to one another, and I was trying to run away from him, and I feel very bad about that. So just don't say hello, ladies, when I have a child, and don't wear a hat. That's the moral of the story, and I will pray for the Holy Spirit to open my heart on this Pentecost. May we pray. Oh, holy God, it has been a week. Another week in which there has been pain and suffering, and death that has come for no reason. And so we come into this place where we can laugh, and we can cry, and we can ask questions, and we can explore, and we can seek the ways in which we are to not just be a passive part of this world and of this community, but the ways in which we are truly called to help transform and change the world. Through action, through community, through peace, and through love. So open our hearts so that we might look one another in the eye and see each other for who we are, and we might sense deep within the strength and the courage to do what is right, to speak up, to serve, and to love. In the name of the one in whom we live and move and have our being, we pray. Amen.
I'd like to ask all you super fine people, even Joe, to stand right now and sing with us, please. And also, this is super duper time to bring your offering to the table.
Let's get it. Lori's going to lead us off with this one.
But this morning, of course, is Pentecost. It's the Sunday we celebrate Pentecost, 50 days, 7 weeks after the Passover, or for us as Christians, after Easter, when we celebrate the birth of church. Here's what I'd like for you to do this morning instead of greeting with one another with passings of peace. We did this last week, and we're going to try this for a couple of Sundays as well, mix it up. But I'd like for you to turn to someone. Don't just turn to someone. Find someone else as well. But take a moment and say, you are welcome. Just look at one another and say, you are welcome. And go and make sure you've said that. Look around and make sure everybody's been told that.
You are welcome. And I'm glad you got up and came to church today. I like your sermon title.
Good morning.
You are welcome.
Thank you, and you are welcome too. Good morning. You are welcome. Good morning. You're all welcome. Thank you.
Mom,
you're welcome.
Glad you came.
You're welcome too.
You are welcome.
Thank you.
Welcome.
You're welcome, Ben.
You are welcome.
Are you next? Oh, I guess so, yeah. There's your microphone. Oh, they will. Yeah, they will eventually. It's on.
Testing. Warning, it's time for our scripture reading. Today's scripture reading comes from Acts chapter 2, and it is quite long. And so I hope it's okay with everyone. I have a more modern translation. Hopefully that will add some dramatic flair. So here we go. This is most of Acts 2. 7 weeks had gone by since Jesus' death and resurrection, and the day of Pentecost had now arrived. As the believers met together that day, suddenly there was a sound like the roaring of a mighty windstorm in the skies above them. and it filled the house where they were meeting. Then what looked like flames or tongues of fire appeared and settled on their heads, and everyone present was filled with the Holy Spirit and began speaking in languages they didn't know, for the Holy Spirit gave them this ability. Many godly Jews were in Jerusalem that day for the religious celebrations, having arrived from many nations. And when they heard the roaring in the sky above the house, crowds came running to see what it was all about and were stunned to hear their own languages being spoken by the disciples. How can this be? They exclaimed. For these men are all from Galilee, and yet we hear them speaking in our own native languages of the lands where we were born. They stood there amazed and perplexed. What can this mean? They asked each other. But others in the crowd were mocking. They're drunk, that's all, they said. Then Peter stepped forward with the 11 apostles and shouted to the crowd, "Listen, all of you, visitors and residents of Jerusalem alike. Some of you are saying that these men are drunk. Well, it isn't true. It's much too early for that. People don't get drunk by 9 a.m. No. What you see this morning was predicted centuries ago by the prophet Joel. In the last days, God said through Joel, I will pour out my Holy Spirit upon all people, and your sons and daughters shall prophesy, and your young men shall see visions, and your old men dream dreams. Yes, the Holy Spirit shall come upon all my servants, men and women alike, and they shall all prophesy. Amen.
Spring rain fell, saw the water from a deeper well.
Love that. I love that song. That song is so poignant, and it's poignant for today, especially as we think of the Holy Spirit. And then, of course, we've got the rain. But then who hasn't always felt that urging, that longing? I found this quote earlier this week. It's on the back of your bulletin from St. Augustine. Oh, Holy Spirit, descend plentifully into my heart and lighten the dark corners of this neglected dwelling and scatter there thy cheerful beams. Third century, I think, St. Augustine. Who hasn't had that same cry? No matter where our reasoning takes us, no matter where our logic takes us sometimes, when have we not found ourselves just calling out into the darkness, into the hope, and calling and longing for something to fill those places that seem empty suddenly, that seem broken? And perhaps in this last week, we know that is certainly happening down near Houston in Santa Fe, Texas, and certainly it's happening in other parts of the world, and just seems like that kind of thing is never ending and overwhelming. And then the idea then for us today to think about, what is this idea of Pentecost, and what is this idea of Holy Spirit, and is Holy Spirit, it's a thing, is it a thing, what exactly is Holy Spirit? So we're gonna think about this for a couple of days, and maybe it's even more pertinent right now where we are. We're also going to participate in communion, so I'm so glad that you are here this morning for that. But I have to say something just aside at the very beginning. Don't you just love this service? I mean, don't you just love this service? I mean, here's why I love it, is because no matter what I plan, people will get up and do whatever they want to anyway. I love that. I seriously do. It's not a correction or anything. I love that Todd got up and says, I've got my own version I'm going to read here. And it's like, yeah. And then, of course you can get up and speak whatever you want to. I'm not inviting you all to stand up and speak whenever you want to. Then we really will have a Pentecostal charismatic church. And I don't know that I'm capable of going there, okay? That scares me. But it is. It's a beautiful, it's just such a wonderful community. And I'm so glad to be a part of it. I consider it a real honor, you know, to be here. A very humbling honor, in fact. So I want to think with you a little bit about this idea of Holy Spirit. And I tell you what, I'm going to borrow your music stand here. I'll be very careful not to spill the music on here. Oh, good, it's in a binder. But there's only two music stands now in this room. I don't know where they all went to, but we only have two now. So I want to utilize them a little bit for my notes here and just talk about a couple of quick things about Holy Spirit as we think about this idea of what is Holy Spirit. Is it a thing? Is there something else about Holy Spirit? So we have this story, 50 days after the Passover, we have this gathering. It's a great mirror image of the story of Babel. If you remember the story of Babel, okay, I'm sorry. I'm going to do this. I love these flowers, I know, but I'm a short guy. And I'm looking over, and all I see is a flower sticking up instead of a person's face. So we have this story 50 days after the Passover, and they're all gathered. But it's a reversal story. It's like a mirror reversal of the Tower of Babel, right? So if you remember in Genesis, the Tower of Babel is that sort of pourquoi story, that sort of how come story. Why do we have cultures in the world, and they all speak different languages? How do we explain this diversity of people in the world, people who are different than us? And people who don't think like us. And I would even go so far as to say people who are wrong and not like us. How do we have this kind of diversity in the world? Well, it's because of evil. And that's why we have this diversity. Because all of these people once spoke one language, came together, started to build a tower. They were going to become like God. So God scatters them. God confuses them. Now, it's an interesting opposite parallel. God confuses them so that they don't understand each other. And they get scared and scatter. That's what happens when we don't understand each other. We get scared and scatter, or we look for tribes, right? So we have completely the opposite story happening in Acts. It's a reversal of the Genesis story. Now, from all over the known world, which includes basically most of Europe, not far Western Europe, but a lot of Europe, and then the Middle East, basically, and then Northern Africa, present day, that's pretty much the known world. All of those different folks, different languages, different backgrounds, although Jewish, as the story goes, but they are different kinds of Jews. They come from different traditions of Judaism, and some of them are even Hellenized Jews, okay? So they have more of a Greek influence in them than, say, those who are from more the Jerusalem, the region around Jerusalem. They all gather here, and then, as the story goes, Peter begins to speak to them. And as the story says, they all understand each other, right? They begin to hear others speaking in their languages, but they hear them in their own tongue. They hear them in their own language. Now, that seems pretty phenomenal, but today we have an app for that. I mean, really, right? You can go anywhere in the world practically, and you can just, it will translate right there for you. So on the one hand, it seems quite phenomenal, seems quite outstanding, quite unbelievable, and yet now it's quite unusual. If we go to the UN, you'll have people speaking, and we're all understanding what's being said in our own tongue. And partly what I want to suggest to you is that there's something else about this story that is less about the magic trick. Holy Spirit is a whole lot less about the magic trick, but it's easy to get caught up in the magic of the moment. But what I want to suggest is that very intentionally, Luke, by the way, who's only the only author who has this story, right? The Gospel of Luke and the Book of Acts, most every scholar considers those two by the same author. And it's the only place where we find this particular story. But he's trying to say something very specific, and that's what I want to get to in just a moment. Something that's more than simply this idea of something amazing, of magic. And I mean, the reality is that if you've ever traveled, you realize that understanding language is not even the beginning of understanding, right? You know, I mean, my son's been living in Germany for 3 years now, my son and daughter-in-law and granddaughter, and Linda and I studied German. Now, my son speaks fluently, but even speaking fluently now for 5 years, he still gets it all mixed up. And my daughter-in-law still gets it all mixed up. She was emailing me the other day, and it had been raining there, and she said she was walking along and read in the German, "slippery when wet" on the sidewalk, right? She read that, and she walked along and slipped. Hit the ground. And a local German man came over and lifted her up and said, "Clearly you read, but you don't understand." And she said, "Well, no, I understood it in German." She said, but then he said to her, "Well, if you understood it, then you wouldn't have slipped." Which is a cultural understanding, right? It's a whole different way of understanding reality, a whole way that is so rule-oriented and so structured and preventative that you would never travel from one town to the next on half a tank of gas. Why would you do that? You might get stuck out in the middle. There's no petrol stations anywhere between the villages because you would plan before you left. You go to the grocery store, you get all the food. You brought your bag with you, right? Of course you did, because you know to do that ahead of time. My son discovered early on that irony is kind of lost in Germany. So that when he went to his first youth hostel, and he went downstairs and into the office and paid up, she asked him in German, "How was your stay?" And he said in German, "Well, I think the presidential suite, could have been a lot nicer." And she looked with him at all seriousness and said, "Sir, we do not have a presidential suite." And he said, "Well, the sauna wasn't up to par either." And she said, "We don't have a sauna." And he said, "Thank you very much," and walked out the door. The idea of irony just gets lost, right? We misunderstand each other all the time. A friend of mine said they went to Japan, and they noticed that a sign on the door said what it was supposed to say was "visitor's entrance." But what it did say was "the visitors to the door in hopes of coming in." Is exactly what it said in Japanese. But that's how it was translated to them. The visitors to the door hoping to come in. This is their entrance. So we get these things mixed up. We get this idea of communication mixed up all the time. To simply say that everyone understood each other is to miss the whole point. To simply say they comprehended each other's language. Now, I'm going to suggest to you a couple of things, and I hope you don't hear me as disabusing anyone of their experience if they grew up in a charismatic church. I know that a number of you did grow up in Pentecostal churches, and some of you may consider some of those experiences quite moving and influential in your understanding of faith, and I wouldn't want to disabuse you of that. I will say that I did go through a charismatic period of time for about 2 or 3 years as a young adult. I was involved in a group called Cornerstone Ministries here back in the day, way back in the early day. And I have to say that my first experience of speaking in tongues, and actually I have to say my only experience of speaking in tongues, was both overwhelmingly moving and deeply confusing and ultimately tragically embarrassing, because I was speaking in Spanish. I stood there in a room, and I was getting into the worship service. And as the worship continued, after a while, we were invited to go to the upper room. It actually had an upper room, and we were invited to go up there and to receive the Holy Spirit. To which I had no idea what that meant at the time. So I followed my friends. I went up there, and then everyone began to speak. It was warm. It was overwhelming. It was emotional. I was a young adult. I was barely 15. And as the thing, as it began to intensify, the languages or the vocalizations or the glossolalia began to emerge from people all around me, and I felt overwhelmed, and I did the only thing I knew how, and I just started speaking in Spanish. And I thought I could get away with it, not remembering that, in fact, I live in Texas. And the young woman next to me said, "You're asking everyone how they're feeling today." And so I kind of smiled and said, "I'm not sure I know what I'm supposed to do." And it was ultimately very embarrassing. But it didn't dismiss from me what the experience meant for people. I don't want to suggest to you or anyone that an experience is not a real thing. I want to suggest to you that's not what this story is about. But I don't want to suggest to you that how you experience life or what you experience is not a real thing. And that's a challenge, I think, for us. That's a challenge for us because we tend to identify tribally, we tend to identify in terms of groups, and as such, we tend to disassociate from others. We tend to dismiss others' experiences because of how we defend our experiences. Does that make sense to you? The way we orient ourselves, oftentimes we're not thinking in terms of how someone else is. We're thinking how someone else is different and therefore, in some sense, wrong or even, in some sense, mentally ill, we might say. To say the Germans don't have a sense of humor would be a misnomer. It would be a misleading statement, right? Germans do have a sense of humor. It's just not our sense of humor. And our sense of humor makes no sense to Germans, for example. To say someone doesn't know how to communicate is just to assume they don't know how to speak the language that I grew up with in my cultural context. So to say that someone's charismatic experience isn't a real experience would be misleading. Do you remember that story I told you once about the kid at the library who started questioning my storytelling in the middle of a story? It was over in Highland Park, and I'm not saying Highland Park is just rife with these kind of kids by any means, but he's a very smart kid, and he was reading Harry Potter and Deathly Hallows, right? And he was like 9 years old, and he's reading this massive book. And in the middle of my story, he interrupts me, and he says, "Sir," and I'm looking down at he and his mother, and I said, "Excuse me," and he says, "Sir, this story did not really happen." And I said, "Excuse me?" He said, "The story you're telling is not true. You said all the stories you tell are true, and this story is not true." And I said, "Well, what do you mean?" He said, "Well, it didn't really happen. It is a fictional piece of literature." He's a third grader. And I looked at him and I said, "Well, all right, I'm sorry." Now, I could have just tried to skirt the issue, but I thought, I'm just going to build this into the moment. And so I looked at him and I said, "So, let me ask you a question. Would that be all right?" And he said, "Yes." And I said, "So you're reading a book?" He said, "Yes." I said, "So what are you reading?" He says, "I'm reading Harry Potter and the Deathly Hallows." And I said, "That's a very advanced book." And he says, "No, it's pretty easy for me." And I said, "Well, that's great. But can you tell me about this book? When you're reading it, do you feel adventurous at some times? Do you feel excited at some points? And doesn't it get kind of, you start getting a little anxious? Do you ever have those feelings with this book?" And he kind of looked at me and he said, "Yeah." And I said, "And sometimes you kind of laugh and you feel happy and funny because something happened in the book?" And he says, "Yeah." And I said, "Well, let me ask you, are those feelings real feelings? Did they really happen?" And he looked at me for a moment, and then he looked at his mom, and his mom went, and I don't know if he made the connection, right? I don't know if we always make the connection. Sometimes what gets pinned down as history, we find out 100 years later, never really happened, right? And we've based our whole lives on it. Or our whole justification for a belief system, or our whole justification for a political system, or whatever. We've based it on something and found out that it was misinterpreted or intentionally interpreted a different way. Sometimes we say something didn't happen, and does it have any value at all? If I say all of Scripture is just story, does that immediately say to you, well, then it's worthless, it's pointless? Or if I say this particular story is a story with a purpose, did it really happen? My feeling is probably not. A lot of scholars would probably say probably not. A lot of people would say it absolutely did happen. Does it matter? Is there something else there? Can truth speak past historical, concrete moments in time? Do you remember that idea that Einstein fought with quantum physics about? Do you remember that? All of you people, you all scientists, you know quantum physics, right? Do you remember how Einstein, in the 30s, he had this argument with is it Bohr, I think his name was, and he was they were debating over quantum mechanics, that it doesn't happen, it's too mysterious, you can't pinpoint anything, everything is based on a theory of relativity, right? And now, years and years later, now we're proving that, in fact, there is this kind of spooky action that he used to give it a name. He kind of used that word in a way of sort of almost as a put down. What you're talking about is just spooky action, he would say. Well, yeah, in fact, this kind of spooky action actually happens, where one thing is influenced and influences another atom light years away, even, at great distances. And now they've actually pinpointed it. Now, in late April, they found that they could pinpoint some action being influenced to something that's almost visible by the eye, by the naked eye, a photon, a beam of light that is influenced on the other side of the planet and on the moon and out in space. I mean, this ability to see how things influence one another, how do you explain that connection? There's a spookiness to it. And what I want to suggest to you is that the Holy Spirit may not be a thing, may be an invitation. It may not be a sense of what I have to have as much as a sense that I have what I need to respond to or what I'm invited to respond to. My uncle was part of this thing called the Matthew Project. I don't know if any of you knew what the Matthew Project was, but this Matthew Project was where he would go with a group of people and they would take a video that showed, and it was on a big screen back in the day, and it would show the story of Jesus' life and the miracles he would do, and of course they would have Hollywood's effects going on and all this kind of stuff happening on the screen, and they would take it to villages, the Quiche Indian villages up in the mountains of Mexico. And then they would, convert, they would invite people to conversion at that point and baptize them in the Spirit. And what was always interesting, he would come back and I would always kind of look at my uncle and I would say, have those people ever even seen a TV before? And he would say, well, no, they don't have any electricity or anything. I said, so you give them a 30-foot screen and you show them this massive image and then they all convert to Christianity. Now, I didn't argue with him. I mean, I just raised that issue and he'd look at me like, of course, and that's all they needed to do. But my point would be, what's the point in that? Are we just trying to get tickets to heaven? Are we trying to change the world for the kingdom of God? How much of that kind of transformation actually takes place in such moments of magic? If you've ever been to a Penn and Teller show, it's quite amazing. It's really impressive. Everybody gets excited. We all have an experience together, kind of like at a football game, except that you got sides. In magic, you don't have sides necessarily. But you get that excitement, but where is that excitement housed? Where do we hold that excitement? We hold it personally, right? We hold it internally. And I want to suggest to you that the reason why we do communion in here when we do it, and the reason why we do what we do and how we look at life and the kingdom of God the way we do, is because, again, it's not about me and it's not about you. The gospel is always about everyone. It's always about us. I recently heard someone talking about how good our culture has become at recognizing what it means to be human, but not at what it means to be at our own humanity. We've recognized what it means to be a being in a body, to be human, but we haven't recognized what it means to be a part of humanity. It's the same problem. 3,000 souls coming, being converted doesn't change anything unless it's about changing how we see one another, how we experience one another. So I want you to think about this word understanding as we go into this little series for a couple of weeks and as we think about what it means to be inspired. We're getting ready to move from this place to another place, right? It's a little challenging, I think. There's aspects of it that, as Sharon brought up a few weeks ago, this idea, a lot of us had met our friends for the first time here. A lot of our friends we've met in this space. A lot of us had that experience of our mind and our eyes being opened in this space. And we're leaving this space for another. There's a lot of challenge in that. But we don't do it alone, right? We do it together as a community. And it doesn't remain our community over there, because it becomes something much more. And if it doesn't become something much more, I'll tell you what will happen. It will die. Right? It will just die. That's what classes do, Sunday school classes, over time. That's what certain communities do over time. If we don't realize and remember constantly that the Holy Spirit is not about you or me, but it's about what we discover in inviting others, and not just inviting others to be a part of the community, but inviting others into relationship, into welcoming. If we don't do that, then our communities begin to die. They just begin to wither. So what I want you to invite you to do is to think about this word understanding, not as comprehending, but as something I read recently in the United Methodist Insight magazine. This coming annual conference, we'll all be gathered, all of our delegates will gather, and we'll listen to the arguments and to the proposals that have been presented by the Way Forward, the Commission on the Way Forward. Those things we'll have to vote on in 2019, but that'll be at the agenda. That'll be a big part of the agenda of our annual conference. But it's interesting, already the luncheons have gone out, the invitations to luncheons, and already the not just the seminary luncheons for your alumni, but then the Wesleyan Covenant Association has had is inviting everybody to come have lunch with them so you can learn more about what they represent, which is, you know, fairly strong held stance on how things are going should go in our Methodist Church. Then you have the Uniting Methodist Church, which has been more of an open church kind of response to the Wesleyan Covenant Association, which has been more inviting and says that we're more about being diverse and being together in our diversity. But here's what's interesting: when they invited you to lunch to come with them, they said, "We will be having a lunch, but it won't be anywhere specific. It's going to be wherever you go out and invite somebody you completely disagree with to have lunch with you." They said, "We're going to have a lunch. Yeah, there will be a uniting lunch, but it won't be happening in any one place. It's going to happen wherever you decide to go out and invite someone to lunch who completely disagrees with you, so that you can begin to open up to one another." What an idea. That's what communion's about. Communion, which we're about to take part in, is not about this idea of putting a stamp on my, you know, on my ticket. It's not about confirming my spirit to God. It's about reminding me that I'm about invitation. I'm about being open. That's what the message of the gospel is. The gospel is good news for everyone. Everyone's included. How do we do that? So before I invite DeAndrea to come up here and get us started in that, I've written a lot about this in the last few emails, so I don't know that there are any questions, but let me ask if there are any questions at all about our move that come to mind, just one or two. We're going to do this each Sunday. If you didn't get one answered the Sunday, then we'll open it up next Sunday again. We won't have any meetings after church to do this. We're just going to invite you to think about it here. But any questions at all? Yes, thank you.
You could have any coffee?
When we have coffee. We will have better coffee. I shouldn't say that. That's just a ploy. No, we'll have coffee. We'll have good coffee, though. Yeah, we will have local. We're going to try to buy locally grown. Yes?
How many people will it hold?
It will hold 200 people in the round, and that's without getting too crowded. So right now we have about 130 in here, so it will hold. It will hold us pretty well, and then room for growing as well. Yeah. That will come after that? That's great. Good question. At that point, we have to figure out something different. Yeah, we'll hold two services. Yeah, we might hold two services. I don't know, but thank you. I like that. I agree with you. I think we're going to have that problem. I definitely think we'll have that problem. I can't wait to be in that space. Yes?
Can we bring donuts and food to pass out, share with everybody?
Can you bring food to share with others?
Yeah.
Absolutely. Yes. I invite that. Yes, sir. It's going to be right across the parking lot on the east side of the church. It's going to be on 4th Street. It's 512 4th Street in the old YWCA building, also called the Historic 512. And we're on the second floor. There'll be lots of flags out. You'll see it on the 10th. Nobody's asked this question. I'm going to answer it for you really quickly before we have our communion. A number of young families, I'm sure, would be concerned that you have to be anxious about getting over here to the nursery in time to pick up the children, because nursery workers will start leaving early or leaving at noon o'clock. At noon, we've actually contracted with the nursery child care workers. They will be there till 12:45 to 1 o'clock if needed. So they're contracted for the extra hour. So there's no anxiety about that extra 5 minutes to get across the parking lot into the children's wing. So,
Ed be there with his hat on?
Hmm?
Will Ed be there with his hat on?
Oh, would Joe be there with his hat on? Yes. Will? Absolutely. Sure. We can request that. We'll build that into. Yeah. Anything else? Another question. I'll be calling on some of you, Sharman. I've already talked to some of you, and I'll call on a few others of you, because I really would love to have your presence there to be greeters as well. We're going to need folks to be doing some greeting outside as well as inside, and to help with some setup. We're going to have an outdoor tent there on the corner, and then, of course, all the flags and stuff. So just having some different folks helping and being present is going to be great. So if there's no other questions, then let me just invite DeAndrea. The band can come on up. We're going to sing while we're doing communion as I go down to the river to pray, and invite you to join along with that quietly. We'll be doing that quietly. And we'll have two stations. We're going to have one station there at that entrance, or right at the end of the aisle there, and then a station right here. So you can go either direction. It'll be by intinction, by dipping bread into the cup. All right? And then I'm going to ask, would Margaret, would the two of you, George and Margaret, would y'all help out as well? Okay? Yes. Oh, no, go ahead. Yeah. No, you use that.
On the night in which Jesus gathered with his best friends in the upper room, they were people that he had walked and journeyed with. They saw things very different than one another, but he invited them to come with him on the journey. And so they gathered, and he lifted up a loaf of bread, and he took it, and he broke it, and he gave thanks to God, and he said, "Take and eat, for this is my body, which is given for you. Do this in remembrance of me." And then after the supper, he took a cup, he gave thanks to God, and he looked at all of them, knowing that they were not perfect, that they were going to betray him, that they were going to make choices that were not his own, and he still said, "Take and drink from this, all of you. For this is my cup of the new covenant poured out for you and for many for the forgiveness of all of you." And so we come and we partake in this holy meal, which is an open table, which means that everyone who is here, no matter who you are or where you've been or what tradition you have come from or what we've done in this life, we are all welcome to come and partake of this meal, because it is a gift of love given to each of us so that then we can share that love with others. So come now and receive.
As I went down in the river to pray, studying about that good old way, and who shall wear the starry crown, good Lord, show me the way. Oh, sisters, let's go down. Let's go down, come on
Around for just a minute here because we're so glad to have Krista with us this morning. She's going to do this beautiful song at the end, and then we'll stand for a blessing.
Birds flying high, you know how I feel. Sun in the sky, you know how. Reeds drifting on by, you know how I feel. It's a new dawn, it's a new day, it's a new life for me, and I'm feeling good. It's
So let's all stand for blessing. Sun is out, by the way, folks. Isn't that nice? Take someone's hand. Let's pray. Holy One, as we leave this place, and as we leave this place as a part of this idea of being the church in the world, empower us in ways of understanding, of not so much trying to find someone else's meaning in our life as much as to try to be a bridge, to actually stand between opinions, to stand between orientations, to stand between tribes as a way of trying to open up understanding. Bless us as we leave this place, that we might be that spirit in the world. We pray in the name of the one in whom we live, and we move, and have our being. Amen.
Thank you.